me just about 5 minutes on the way up to Atlanta. Be cruising at 17,000 feet today. Might not be in the air just about 35 minutes. Picked a beautiful day for flying. We have clear skies all the way along. A little bit of thin overcast here and thereabouts. Nothing of any consequence. The weather in Atlanta is about what you're looking at here. Temperature up in the low 40s. So we're glad you could join us. Sit back, relax, and let us in our wings. Thank you.
Whenever you fly a commercial airlines, you place your life in the hands of the pilot and crew of the aircraft. But you don't see the person who has ultimate control of the aircraft, a person on the ground equally responsible for your safety in the air, the air traffic controller. As you fly, important activity is going on behind the scenes, in the tower and in the radar room, activity which controls the movement of the plane.
Pacer 5-3, monitor Maxwell Tower on 253.5, report Millbrook.
Eastern 106, can you be at 2,012 miles?
Yeah, I think we could get pretty close to that.
Hummy 911, ground 348.6.
Roger, sir.
Hummy 765, clear to land runway 9, and if you would expedite, please.
765, roger.
Command 45 uniform, you follow on a helicopter on about a 1 mile final, report him in the Cardinal 240, how far out are you?
2 miles northeast.
Dialogue such as this goes on continuously, from the time the plane leaves the gate until the time it arrives at its destination. A plane can't move without clearance from an air traffic controller. Montgomery air traffic controllers work in the airport tower at Danley Field and at Radar Approach Control, or RAPCON, located at Maxwell Air Force Base. RAPCON controllers monitor the airspace for 30 miles around Montgomery. Each controller on duty has a certain sector of airspace for which he's responsible. As an aircraft approaches Montgomery, it leaves the Atlanta Center, which has control of airspace outside that of Montgomery control.
Eastern 265, fly heading 230, send to maintain 5,000 at pilot's discretion.
Okay, 230 on the heading and down to 5,000, Eastern 265.
The controllers then assign the plane a coded number, which they punch up on radar. It shows the aircraft and its altitude and can be followed visually. From that point on, the RAPCON controller is in charge of the aircraft.
Eastern 265, descend and maintain 3,000. Contact Montgomery Approach 124.0.
Okay, I'm down to 3,000. 24.0, Eastern 265. Montgomery Approach, Eastern 265, we can get a 5-3.
Eastern 265.
Eastern 265, Old Millbrook for an ILS, TV.
Eastern 265, descend and maintain
2,000.
Bravo, Montgomery Approach.
In the control room, the radar controller is the one on headsets. Assisting him is a data man who works the board assigning the plane its code and who handles other necessary communications, leaving the radar controller free to follow the radar screen. If there's a lot of traffic in the air, a coordinator assists the data man. About 8 miles out of Danley Field, Montgomery Control turns the plane over to Montgomery Tower, which brings the plane in.
Eastern 265, monitor tower 119.7, report the marker inbound. Good morning.
In the tower, the controller working local control takes over from RAPCON. He's responsible for all planes landing and taking off. Tower controllers don't work with radar. Their main tools are their radio and their binoculars.
Eastern 265, runway 9 are clear to land. Eastern 265, if able, turn left to taxiway Tango in front of the tower, ground point 9 and winning clear.
All right.
Houston 265, taxi to the ramp.
Okay.
Yeah.
taxis from the runway, the ground controller takes over. The plane makes it safely to its gate. Much has been written about the pressure on air traffic controllers. Pressure built up by the responsibility of the job, responsibility for thousands of lives each day. But successful air traffic controllers come to accept the responsibility and the pressure. Some even appear to thrive on it.
I don't feel like there's a lot of pressure on me. I know that the general consensus among the people that I talk with that are not familiar with what they do, the things that they read and things that they see, that's the first question everybody asks. You know, is there pressure with the job? There is and there isn't. You realize there is a lot of responsibility with this job. A pilot has a lot of responsibility, you know, but that pilot is working one airplane, or he is driving one airplane. And at any given time, any controller may be working six or seven of those airplanes with any number of people on board those airplanes responsible for separating those airplanes. And so the responsibility is great. And from that standpoint, yes, there is pressure. There is some pressure. And I mentioned to you earlier that I feel like that it takes a certain breed of cat to do the job. And I don't know, I think it's a prerequisite that air traffic controllers have to be somewhat egotistical in that they have to say, I can do the job. I know I can do the job, and they do it.
There's an air traffic controller on duty 24 hours a day. Though each controller works an 8-hour shift, he only works about an hour and a half on any one position. These controllers make instantaneous decisions hundreds of times a day, decisions which affect your safety while flying. They don't like to think about the negative aspects of the job, what could happen. They want to make sure nothing serious does happen. Before your pilot welcomes you aboard the plane, before you've had your first drink or magazine, the pilot and air traffic controllers begin their task of ensuring a safe flight.
Montgomery Clearance, Eastern 106, Lake Clarence to Atlanta.
Eastern 106, Montgomery Clearance delivery. Cleared to Atlanta via fly runway heading direct LaGrange, direct, maintain 10,000. Expect 17,010 minutes after departure. Departure control frequency will be 121.1, squawk 5222.
Eastern 106,
Lake Clarence. 1090, variable 100 at 5, altimeter 3051, hold short to runway 15.
0715
for 9. Eastern 106, we're going to ground proceed to Ross 15.
Eastern 106, Lake
Clarence. Okay, roger. Eastern 106, cleared for takeoff.
106.
And you're off to your business meeting, vacation, home, all the while being watched and guided by the air traffic controllers. This is Glenda Webb reporting for Alabama Illustrated.
Eastern 106, contact the pilot. Have a good day.
Come on now.
It's mainly because we are the only traveling fashion show of its kind and its size in the country. We travel for 7 months. We have 200 garments and we have a staff of 13 models. So it is quite a spectacular event. And in many cases, the largest event in some of the small cities around the country.
Yeah.
began over 21 years ago by the president of Dean University's wife, who wanted to have a fashion show for charity. She asked Mrs. Johnson and Mr. Johnson to sponsor it, and it caught on, and it's been going for 21 years now. It's different in every entire city. That's why it's not boring to us. We show the same show for 175 shows, but because the runway is different, because the lighting's different, and because the people are different, each show is an entirely different event. And we look forward to a very responsive audience. We love for the people to relax and scream and yell if they feel like it. The men love, if they like the lingerie, you know, say so. I mean, the models just love it. The more the audience responds, the more the models will perform for them. The tailored look is in. It's in to stay for this season as well. It started last fall and it's going to continue through the spring. It's a tailored look, a man tailoring in ladies' clothes. The lengths are shorter, showing more leg, and the clinched waistline is back. So the feminine form has returned. Anything from the 40s, the 40s look has been refined and is very important this season. That's where we get the slightly padded shoulders in the tailored suits. And the seamed hose, the extravagant hats. Hats are very important this season. In fact, all accessories are very important. They love the male models, but the bikini scene gets to be a little quiet sometimes, unless the men respond. The women sort of sit back. Entertainment. This is not the typical fashion show. Most fashion shows have an aim to sell the garments. We're not here to sell clothes. We're here to entertain. It's a two-hour production of entertainment. And our medium is the fashion. We pack houses throughout the country, and I think it goes to show that people, black people especially, are people of color. And we enjoy the extravagance of the furs and the lace and the evening gowns. And you can see that from the audiences this evening.
You may be asking, what's involved in this movie-making venture? Well, of course, there are the stars, the director-producer, a couple of associate producers, the first assistant director, the second assistant director, the script man, a photographer, two camera operators, two assistant camera operators, and, of course, the crab dolly operator. Then you've got the sound men, one on a tape recorder, the other holding a microphone, a lighting crew, and electricians, plus makeup persons, hairdressers, extras, stand-ins, and sightseers, not to mention the truck drivers and even a cooking staff, and that's not all. The man charged with the responsibility of bringing all these people and equipment together is internationally acclaimed director John Barry. We talked with Barry about his reasons for accepting the director's job for Sisters.
I was given a script to read, and I thought it was an absolutely unusual, original piece of work about the South and people who live in the South that I have never seen before, never seen on a screen before. Mm-hmm. And I, of course, Maya Angelou, who wrote the story, impressed me, and then I decided that it would certainly be something I'd like to do.
This is not your stereotyped black relationship between sisters and a minister who is supposed to be the good guy, the leader in the community. This could just as easily have been a situation with whites as well as blacks.
I hope that that will be true, and I think it is true. As a matter of fact, I feel and I have, I think the details will be related to black life, but that the emotions, the relationships are relationships of people.
And is this a statement for the black community?
I don't know if it's a statement for the black community. I think it's a statement for all people. It is about family life.
In watching Barry work, it became obvious that he's a meticulous artist who concentrates on every important camera angle.
Well, I don't know if it's a style and technique of my own. It's a whole past of movie making which leads me to work that way. And actually, I think each film has its own style. And I suppose each director has his own style. But I can't say that many directors cover themselves in many, many angles. What I do is try and cover those things, the scenes that I feel are necessary, by being sure that I have every moment that I want to be on the screen.
The fact that Sisters is a made-for-TV movie doesn't significantly change Barry's style of directing.
I don't do, I do some very slight things. Mostly I feel of motion pictures are motion pictures, and I think that they work for television as they do on a screen. It's the audience reaction and the way in which they receive a picture which is slightly different. That is to say, some people think television has to be all close shots. I don't believe that.
But at the same time, the time limitations, the shooting schedules.
Oh, well, the shooting schedules do are more limited in terms of television. However, I also feel that on the particular film that I'm making at the present moment, that if I had too much time, I think it would hurt the picture. Mm-hmm. Curiously enough, I think this picture should be done rapidly, and I think many pictures should. You're more inventive, you work in another way. Otherwise, it becomes too heavy. Mm-hmm. It's interesting. I think John Ford made The Informer in about, if I'm not mistaken, between 3 and 4 weeks, which is one of an enormous picture. I don't know how long Ingmar Bergman shoots his pictures, but I don't think that it is always right to have an unlimited time.
The man who works as John Barry's right-hand man is First Assistant Director Len Braum.
My job is to coordinate all the men and equipment and actors to make sure that everything is in the right place at the right time. The production manager provides me the tools by seeing that we have everything here in Montgomery, but it's my job to make sure it gets to the set when we need it.
How would you describe the production so far?
Well, it's a very difficult production to do because of the dramatics that are demanded of it, and we are doing it for television, which doesn't give us the schedule that, let's say, a feature film would have. A feature motion picture of the same length, they might take, 10 weeks to do. We're doing this film in 4 weeks, and yet we want to have the same quality. So it means that our operation has to be that much tighter. Every show is a battle. Francois Truffaut has a very interesting analogy to movie making. He likens it to a stagecoach ride. You look forward to a pleasant journey when you start out, but along the way you finally just want to get there.
One of the central figures in the movie is portrayed by Dick Anthony Williams, who plays the part of a frustrated, politically ambitious minister caught up in a vicious set of circumstances involving the sisters.
He's quite a human being. He's a man caught in turmoil between trying to become a senator and then having to make a certain unpleasant moves to become a senator, and then and being very much for his community and very much humanitarian, you know. I think it's a great script. It's a departure from the regular stereotype scripts, you know, pro-women or pro-men or pro-black or pro-white. It could just as easily be a white script. I mean, you could change the characters to white, change a few words, and you still would have, a very terse, dramatic script.
The fact that a major motion picture for television is being filmed here in Montgomery is no accident. The Alabama Film Commission has actively pursued the motion picture industry and has been successful in bringing a number of productions to the state. Included in the list of movies shot in their entirety or in part in Alabama are Close Encounters of the Third Kind, shot in an abandoned blimp hangar in Mobile, The Hollywood Stuntman in Tuscaloosa, The Ravengers, a Columbia release filmed in Birmingham, Mobile, and Huntsville, and Norma Ray, another 20th Century Fox production, shot on location in Opelika. The executive director of the Film Commission is Phil Cole. Why do the studios come to Alabama?
Well, we feel that the cooperation here in our state that we've been able to generate now, right directly from the governor's office, and the tremendous cooperation from state agencies such as the highway department and troopers, the state troopers, and say the prison commission, the governor's office itself, the Bureau of Publicity and Information, who our office is affiliated with, that's an asset. They know that they're not going to be just left here once they start filming. We'll be right here to assist them. Plus the fact the topography of our state. We have a varied area, a tropical area in the southern part of the state, and the mountains and the lakes and rivers and things through the northern part in our rural communities and metropolitan cities. It's different. It's unique. Never before on film, a lot of things that they're filming, this particular show, incidentally. So this is an asset. They're looking for new places to come and assistance that they can receive. And all in all, it just worked out as a good marriage.
And judging by the comments from many of the cast and crew of Sisters, it's been an enjoyable experience.
It's quite a departure from the stereotypic presentation of the South that you usually hear about. I mean, the people here are warm, they're generous, they're kind, friendly. I mean, I've met some tremendous people here, and I gauge a place really by the people. You know, whatever the weather, the other conditions is, the people make a place, and the people in the South have been, particularly in Montgomery, have been fantastic to me.
I must say this, it's a lovely town, and I'm very glad I had the opportunity to see Alabama for the first time.
When I first came down here, I was greeted by the Alabama Film Commission, I think it is, and I think the man's name is Phil Cole, if I'm not mistaken, and I just want to publicly say thank you to him, because the cooperation and the kind of work that we've been able to do has just been marvelously due to his help to me.
It's still very much a wait-and-see situation. There have been no written notifications from any department heads telling any employee he or she has been terminated. Governor James has ordered a freeze on all new hiring, has instructed department heads where he has direct appointment authority to lay off all employees making more than $15,000 annually and are on probationary status. Non-merit provisional appointments are to be trimmed as well. The State Personnel Department says it has not seen any notices to employees who come under such classifications. Termination notices must come through the Personnel Department and be in writing. Names of employees who might be affected by the governor's memorandum are not available. Governor James has used three sections of the Alabama Code in implementing part of his austerity program. Section 36-26-26 is the most direct. It authorizes the layoff of any employee by an appointing authority whenever it is deemed necessary because of a shortage of work or a shortage of funds. The governor says the state is faced with a financial crunch. James wants a report next week on the number of employees affected. He could reveal what department heads will implement cutbacks Monday. A news conference has tentatively been scheduled for that day. Reporting from the state capitol, George Mitchell, WSFA TV News.
The Montgomery County Probate Judge's Office has until noon Friday to certify the four areas of voting in Tuesday's annexation election. So far, three of those areas, those to the east, to the west, and the city-county section, have been certified. Bob Smith is the chief clerk in the Probate Judge's Office. What is the problems with certifying the southern section?
We have reason to believe that two votes that were cast in the southern area were incorrectly tallied against the city-county. They should have been tallied against the South. Those two votes were no votes, and it is our duty to determine that, in fact, all votes are registered where they were intended to be cast. And at this point in time, we cannot make that determination, so we are withholding certification of the South area until such time as a determination is made.
And who is being asked to make this determination?
This will be made by the circuit court. We have petitioned the circuit court for a judgment as to the validity of the South Area annexation vote.
If the circuit court determines that the two votes should have been included in the tally from the South, what will this change from the original unofficial results that came out Tuesday night?
This will put the South Area vote in a tie, which means that the South area will not be annexed. An affirmative vote is required for annexation, and a tie vote is not an affirmative vote.
The posture of the vote of the southern section is now in the hands of the Circuit Court of Montgomery. Just when a decision will be made is not known, but it is expected sometime next week. Dennis Latham, WSFA TV News.
Meet the newest addition to Montgomery's ever-growing zoo, a five-day-old llama. The llama, a male, was born Tuesday morning and is the fifth llama to be born at the Montgomery Zoo. The llama is a native of the Andes Mountains, where its traditional role is that of a beast of burden. Its hair is also used for clothing. Now, this llama will grow to around 250 pounds and will probably be traded to another zoo eventually, since Montgomery already has a male llama. A trip to the zoo wouldn't be complete without checking on Jimbo, the baby chimp born January 19th. Now here's what Jimbo looked like the day after his birth. And here is what he looks like now, just 2 days shy of being 1 month old. Liza, Jimbo's mother, still clings to him closely, and she'll continue doing that for several months. Jimbo will stay with Liza until he's about 4 or 5 years old. There are a lot of things happening at the zoo. And with these two latest arrivals, the folks at the zoo are very happy. And that's worth kicking up your heels for. Michael Jones, WSFA TV News at the Montgomery Zoo.